A lot of you really enjoyed my video on the Cincinnati Reds offseason acquisitions, so I figured I'd also do one on the White Sox. The Southsiders had a surprising 42-44 record at the All-Star break, but would struggle a bit down the stretch, finishing with a record of 72-89. Their offense produced quite a large number of hits, thanks in part to batting champ Tim Anderson, but they didn't have many extra base hits. They were 13th in the AL in doubles, triples, homers, and runs scored, and were last in walks. Their pitching wasn't great either, as they were in the bottom half of the AL in most categories. But the White Sox addressed their team in a big way this offseason, so let's take a look at six new faces the team has brought in. My name is Bobby, and welcome back to Stat Stories. Quick shout out to Baseball Euphoria for suggesting this topic, and remember, if you have a suggestion, leave it in the comments section. We'll start with position players, and specifically the position of catcher, where the White Sox signed Yasmani Grandal to a 4-year, $73 million contract. You can make a case that Grandal is the best catcher in baseball right now, and at the very least is second to JT Realmuto. Over the past 5 seasons, Grandal has averaged 5 wins above replacement, a weighted runs created plus of 117 or 17% better than the league average hitter, and 23 home runs. But offensive ability isn't the most important part of a catcher's game. After all, the White Sox already have 2019 All-Star James McCann, who had a breakout year at the plate. The difference between these two catchers is defense. Baseball Prospectus has the best metrics for catchers, breaking them down into framing, blocking, and throwing. Framing is the most important skill in terms of run prevention, and Grandal saved 19 runs with that skill alone in 2019. His blocking is also really good, ranking 8th best in baseball last year. Throwing is the only area where McCann reigns supreme, but still, Grandal is a major upgrade on defense. Another fun note on Grandal is this chart. He's been very consistent in terms of batting average and slugging percentage, but his on-base percentage has climbed drastically over the past 3 years thanks to his ability to draw walks. His 17.2 walk percentage in 2019 was second in the majors to only Mike Trout, and his 109 total walks is more than Jose Abreu, Leury García, Eloy Jimenez, and Tim Anderson had combined. Billy Bean approves. Next, we move to the outfield, where Jimenez and rookie Luis Robert will play left and center respectively. That leaves right field open, where the White Sox had 5 players make at least 20 starts last year. 4 of them combined for negative 2.6 wins above replacement, and the other player is Leury García. García is fast and a good fielder, but doesn't get on base much or hit the ball very hard. The same can be said of Adam Engel, who played a lot in center last year, though he's even faster and even better defensively. In hopes of getting more offensive production in the outfield, the White Sox acquired Nomar Mazara from the Rangers via trade. As a rookie in 2016, Mazara did fine, putting up numbers that would make you say, okay, not bad for someone his age, let's see how he improves upon it next year. Except now, we've been saying that for 4 years. Now, Mazara is still a below average offensive player, but has the power potential that García and Engel don't have. He'll only be 25 for the 2020 season, and at the least will provide a left-handed bat on a team filled with righties and switch hitters. Moving on to designated hitter, where the White Sox had Yonder Alonso for half a season among other players, though that didn't really work out. The free agent signing for this position was the veteran slugger Edwin Encarnacion on a 1-year, $12 million contract. Edwin has been one of the most consistent power threats in baseball over the past decade, hitting between 32 and 42 homers each season since 2012. His 129 weighted runs created plus last year isn't as high as his peak years in Toronto, but still would have been the third best mark on the White Sox. The only real concerns here are an increased strikeout rate over the past 2 seasons, and the fact that he'll be 37 years old in 2020. Encarnacion still hits the ball hard though, so expect to see him walk the parrot 30 plus times again this season. Now we take a look at the White Sox starting rotation, where 2 veteran lefties were signed in Dallas Keuchel and Gio Gonzalez. See, after Carlos Rodon had to undergo Tommy John surgery in May, the White Sox handed some starts to lefties Manny Benuelos and Ross Detweiler. It didn't go so well. Aside from being quality left-handed pitchers, what Keuchel and Gonzalez provide to the team is experience and a track record of success. Both pitchers are 2-time All-Stars and will provide a veteran presence in an otherwise young rotation. Keuchel will be 32 years old in 2020 and remains one of the best pitchers in the majors at inducing ground balls. In fact, his career ground ball rate of 58.9% is the best among starting pitchers since his debut in 2012. Keuchel doesn't throw hard, and aside from his Cy Young winning season in 2015, he doesn't strike many batters out. Instead, he relies on pitch movement to induce soft contact. There are a few causes for concern, though. Last season, Keuchel posted his highest walk rate since his rookie season, hit a career-high 9 batters, and also served up more hard contact than ever before. His ERA was still below 4, though, and it's worth mentioning that he didn't sign with a major league team until June last season. With a standard offseason this go-round, there's hope that Keuchel will improve upon his 2019 season. As for Gonzalez, his career has been based on consistency. Since 2010, Gio has made at least 30 starts in a season 8 times, posted an ERA under 4 8 times, and had a wins above replacement above 3 7 times. Last year was a bit different for him, as he started off in the Yankees minor league system for a month before making his way to the Brewers starting rotation. While he only threw 87.1 innings, he had a pretty typical year for his standards. Like Keuchel, Gonzalez isn't a power pitcher and excels at limiting hard contact, though he does walk quite a few batters. The biggest concern with Gio is his age, as he'll be 34 in 2020 and has thrown almost 2,000 innings in his career. But as long as he stays healthy, you can expect another quality season out of him. The last player we're going to touch on is right-handed reliever Steve Cishek. Cishek has been a quality relief pitcher for the past decade and has consistently thrown 60-plus innings with an ERA under 3. With the Cubs the past two seasons, he made a combined 150 appearances out of the bullpen. Like our previous two pitchers, Cishek is an older pitcher who doesn't throw very hard, using a sinker as his primary pitch. And while Keuchel and Gonzalez limited hard contact pretty well, Cishek had one of the lowest average exit velocities in the majors last year at 84.5 miles per hour. Now, with the three-batter minimum rule being implemented this season, I figured I'd show how Cishek fares against lefties and righties. Unsurprisingly, he has a better slash line against righties, as he's allowed more homers and walks to lefties while facing fewer left-handed batters, though it's worth noting his walk rate in general is somewhat high. Interestingly, he struck left-handers out at a higher rate than righties in his career. The takeaway here is that Cishek is really good against righties, and isn't all that bad against lefties either, so expect him to continue being a reliable reliever this season. So with all these moves, what can we expect from the White Sox in 2020? Well, they aren't likely to catch the Twins in their division, but the Indians may be within reach. Even if all these new players perform well for the White Sox, they'll need their young core to continue to improve. If that happens, the White Sox will definitely be in contention for a wildcard spot and play meaningful games in September. And maybe they'll make the postseason for the first time since 2008. So thank you for watching and helping Outta Here Baseball pass 1,000 subscribers this past week. Help the channel grow by liking this video and sharing it, and click subscribe if you haven't already. Thanks again for all the support, and I'll see you in the next video.